Welcome to the ultimate 90s talk show, where we take a look at our favorite decade month by month. Today, we're talking February 1992. My name is Daniel. I'm AKA as Draco, your old pal from Game Riff and Madden Man. Join with me, as always, are my two 90s certified experts. Cass, how's it going?
It's going well. I want people to be afraid of how much they love me.
And Wesley, what's going on?
Life is good, brother. It's a beautiful day in the neighborhood.
Let's kick it off with some events from 1992. And we're going to go all the way to February 1st. Starting off the month, slugging outfielder Barry Bonds signs the highest single-year contract ever in MLB history, $4.7 million with the Pittsburgh Pirates. 4.7 sounds kind of like I didn't think about that when I put this note out. 4.7 is no big deal anymore, is it?
Wait, okay. Let me get that again. Barry Bonds signs a contract
single year contract for 4.7. Gotcha. And this was, yeah, at the time, the highest single year contract.
February 92, 4.7.
Yeah.
How quick. Oh, man. So what's the top contract now by contrast?
I don't know, but I bet there's a 10 multiplier to go with it.
For sure. So 4.7, you think, yeah, I'm going to say somewhere between.
It's in double digits.
35, right? Yeah, it's got to be.
We've got NFL guys making $12 million a year.
A-Rod was making, what, 25 mil?
That, yeah, I wanted to say that there was somewhere in the 20 plus million.
Yeah, yeah. A-Rod made 25 mil 10 years ago at least. So let's put it somewhere around 33, 35. All right, whatever. Barry Bonds is the man, though. He deserved it then, and that's testimony to maybe him deserving to be in the Hall of Fame.
Maybe.
Because he was commanding of the highest or the richest contract in Major League Baseball history in 92, several years before
the PEDs.
The PEDs, yeah.
PEDs are going to ruin the legacy of a few of these guys. And I would say, and maybe I've turned into so much of a football and basketball guy over the years that I may not be the one to say this, but I feel like baseball was a bigger deal in the 90s than it is today.
Baseball has been dying, for sure. It's dying a death, so it's more relevant in the 90s than it was today. It's more relevant today than it will be tomorrow. I think it's dying a death.
There is a lot of world records going on in February of 1992. Although the Winter Olympics are coming, there seems to be a lot of track and field records going on. Danny Everett runs a world record 400-meter indoor, 45.2 seconds. And I also should have done my research on that, because surely this is sub 40 seconds nowadays, the way the records continue to get broken.
I wish I knew more about track and field, but yeah. I don't.
The IRS and Willie Nelson settle on a $9 million tax bill instead of the $16.7 million that he owes them. You guys remember the Willie Nelson tax debacle?
No.
No? Okay. So,
like, kind of.
He made a ton of money and never paid his taxes, and it caught up with him, and somehow everyone was feeling really sorry for him.
Yeah, because the government's out to get your money.
When you have a $16 million tax bill, I feel like maybe feeling sorry for someone is in the past. I don't know. That's probably what I don't understand.
There's nothing free about being free. I'm on the record as saying that. Pay your damn taxes.
In the NFL Pro Bowl on February 2nd, the NFC beats the AFC 21-15. MVP Michael Irvin. I feel like, well, two things. This is, the Pro Bowl was more competitive, and it was after the Super Bowl in Hawaii, the way it needs to be now.
Right.
This is just my platform for saying the Pro Bowl is a joke these days.
Fair. The one thing I'll say, though, right, is it's a joke these days because it wasn't much of a game before that, and they tried to make it more relevant and interesting. It just kind of failed. That's the bit I'll say about that. But I have no opinions of the Pro Bowl because it's kind of always been a joke to me.
I don't mind it not being competitive. I just liked the fact that it happened after the Super Bowl and you had like a week of seeing the guys on TV doing the QB challenge and so on. And yeah, like
that's the cool stuff.
This was the farewell to football for this season, kind of like the last goodbye, you know. That was kind of a nice thing.
Yep, I agree with that.
Now we'll take a turn for the worse. On February 5th, the jury selection begins in the L.A. police beating Rodney King case. So, hey, this is – I'm just reviewing the history here. I got two back-to-back bad ones here. So.
Well, yeah, whatever. That happened. That was a thing. Did we have opinions of that? Did I really understand racism in 92? Not really. I was – whatever, we were becoming teenagers. We're becoming young men, so
it was far. Not really. We weren't in a big city. We weren't in LA for sure. So it seemed like some faraway thing where, oh man, things are bad out there. Where I guess we didn't realize things were just not good everywhere still. And
we were kind of shielded from it, you know.
Sure.
We had a wonderful bubble. I'm not going to pretend otherwise.
So there's the insulation of it being in a different region and youth. I'm going to go with more than anything, the insulation of youth and ignorance.
Yeah.
Yeah, whatever, because I wish being the man that I am today, I wish that I could proudly say that I cared more then. But all that I took away from Rodney King is, can't we all get along?
Yeah,
I wish it was more than that.
That's the big catchphrase.
Yeah.
Isn't it sad, like sadly interesting that this was a big deal back in February of 92, and we've seen worse within the last, 5 years? So things have not gotten better, and we were sure that things were going to get better.
Well, I'm going to go with.
I was sure. Maybe I can only speak for myself. I was sure things that would be significantly better by now.
All right. So it's difficult to say that things are worse than the police legit beating a guy on camera. We haven't seen that. What we have seen is police with plausible deniability and deaths. You know what I mean? So
just more incidents, you know, like this was.
Yeah.
No, yeah. This was the only one to be spoken of. And I don't feel like there was much more after this that made big headlines. Unlike what we've seen of late.
It's the fact that this one was recorded. The reason why,
so prevalent at that time.
Still be carrying on like it has been for decades and centuries, if you will. Maybe not centuries, but centuries, if we're being honest. Yeah, you can't beat the crap out of people anymore because we're watching.
Moving from one beating to another, Mike Tyson testifies in his rape trial on February 7th. And this is a cliffhanger that we'll
get. How did it go? Tell me how it went.
I'll tell you how it went in a little while. Okay.
God.
Tears for Mike. February 8th, the 16th Winter Olympic Games opens in Albertville, France. Back in the days, I think this was before they separated the Olympics. So if you had Olympics in 92, you were going to have Summer Olympics in 92 as well.
Is that a thing?
I think so. There was at some point we had a double Winter Olympics, like a 2-year gap instead of a 4-year gap. And that's how they offset them so that we could have some kind of Olympics every other year.
But is that right?
In 92, we still had them both. I'm pretty sure this was before then.
I didn't know that was a thing. I wasn't interested in the Olympics back then. It was just boring sports that I didn't care about until the Dream Team burst on the scene.
Well, the Dream Team's coming this summer. But yeah, I don't know. I've always been oddly fascinated by the Olympics. The figure skating is going to win you over in the Winter Olympics.
Sure. So figure skating and women's gymnastics.
Right.
And then maybe a little track and field with Carl Lewis and Jackie Joyner Kersee. Flo Jo. Yeah, that's the same person, Jackie Joyner Kersee. Those are like the only Olympians I really remember caring about before the Dream Team.
To the volleyball, beach volleyball. Now with, which, you know, I couldn't tell you anything about back then, but, you know, nowadays with, you know, Michael Phelps and there's that female swimmer that's out there dominating. I can't remember her name, but we really got into those now. But in 1992, you know, basketball was, ball was life back then. So
absolutely,
it was just, the Dream Team was all I cared about in these Olympics.
And yeah, I'm terrible with math. Have we established how old we were in 1992? Has this been said?
13.
Right on, yeah. We were 13 years old in 1992. Could care less for the most part. Check you out.
NBA All-Star Game happens on February 9th. The West beats the East 115-113. MVP is the reason of note here. Magic Johnson for the Lakers. Yeah,
was that the HIV year?
Yeah, this is comeback season.
Year. Yeah, that's the return year, right?
Yep, you keep spoiling the future part of this trivia list. This is their second. This is strike two. Hey,
you're getting into our wheelhouse here.
Right, in my bag.
That's right. Hey, taking a moment while we're on sports, we had to make two addendums to last week. One, Junior Seau never won a Super Bowl. I thought he won.
He also didn't play for 30 years.
I did not do my investigative journalism on the 30-year thing, but I did take a moment to, I wanted to see which Super Bowl he won, and what I found was those blasted New York Giants was the Super Bowl, and maybe just one of the Giants Super Bowls, probably the first one. That he didn't make it, and there was
that the perfect season or the
That was the perfect season. Yeah, that the perfect season was the first one that the Giants spoiled. Yeah,
yeah, that's the Randy Moss season to me.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Come on, man.
February 8th, Ulysses spacecraft passes Jupiter. That's pretty far away. And
that is pretty far away.
Speaking of the Olympics, on February 10th, 1992, Bonnie Blair wins the first gold medal for USA. Oh, the second is so we have to split a correct call here. Alabama is the 1992 football college champions, right?
I thought so. Yeah, I felt bad
because of how you. You know, the bowl game is played the following year. So what we were looking at here is I said, who won the 1992 national championships? The correct answer is Alabama. But on, you know, January of 1992, we were playing for the 1991 national championship.
That's right.
And that's I so the rock is cooking. Totally my mistake there, you know, semantics. But you were correct when you said Alabama was the 1992 champions.
So. Yeah, I feel like Alabama fans in the world would have rightly judged me had I had I not known that championship, because I tout that as my first championship.
You gained the your beloved in their hearts now.
Yeah, no doubt. Cheers to us, Roll Tide.
All right, so we're going to take a break from the trivia. I'm going to come back to the trivia. So this week, and I'm going to make the music a more audible experience as it should be. So. This is new and noteworthy. If it was on the top 40 last month, save for a very few of these, we're not going to mention them this month. So that's how we're going to put the new releases into our monthly list. I have a selection of about 12 songs from the top 40. I'm going to play just a short sample of them. You guys tell me if you can name these songs, starting with this one. I'll jump around a little bit. Let's see if I can find the chorus.
That's the that's the name of the song though, right?
That's right.
Yeah.
You guys didn't have any guesses. I had to jump to the chorus.
No, I didn't. I wanted to go with like Boys to Men, but I'm thinking that was way too early.
This is Oochie Coochie by MC Brains and We'll just move on. We'll move on from that one.
Oh, that's Adam's Family Groove.
Yeah.
All right. Big points to anyone who can tell me what he's saying at the last line of the chorus. Here it comes.
Isn't it too legit or something?
So, do what they want to do, say what they want to say, live how they want to play how they want to play. Wow, I've already forgotten the anyway, dance how they want to dance, and I'm pretty sure he's saying kick and they slap a friend.
But what?
Let's try it again. Listen closely.
I'm listening closely. I'm not sure.
Yeah, it's. I didn't look it up, but it's always.
I don't
got
think
me.
He would do that because Hammer is very good on. He was very big on fan respect and respecting the wishes of his fans, and his fans constantly begged him to please not hurt him.
Listen,
so I don't think
I've just googled the lyrics. And it does say kick and they slap a friend. Kick and they slap a friend.
Whatever.
All right. Moving on. Let's see if you can guess this next one for me.
Oh, that's November Rain, isn't it?
Close. You're in the neighborhood.
Live and Let Die.
That's right.
I'm embarrassed by my first answer.
That was better than mine.
So, like them or not, Guns N' Roses was doing well this time of the 90s with two albums, simultaneous releases, I think. I feel like they had 10 singles off these albums, maybe more.
So you're just going to kind of give that little statement on Guns N' Roses like you have zero
completely indifferent.
Zero emotional opinion about this.
I am but your humble host in this musical journey.
All right, fair enough.
You tried so hard in the 90s to bring us around to Guns N' Roses.
Right, right. You spent years getting us to, or trying to get us to love Guns N' Roses. And we
you
get like us, 3 seconds of, oh, well,
they were
Guns N' Roses was a thing.
They were successful. They were a successful band. I've left that life behind me.
So, how about, I found out Slash is, oh my God, what is that? That's Beauty and the Beast, right?
That's right.
Yeah, cheers to Disney for, all right, so shout out to Beauty and the Beast for the beautiful soundtrack that even as a, as like a teenage boy, I was okay with listening to it, and it was super romantic. Maybe not the whole soundtrack, just that song. And then that Be Our Guest. You know, Beauty and the Beast had a great soundtrack.
It did.
What was that? Something about a broken heart?
I know this song.
This is What Becomes of the Brokenhearted by Paul Young.
Nah, I wouldn't have guessed that.
Saw a lot of radio play. I would have guessed the song eventually, you know, but the artist, nah. Here's one of my favorites from this week's list. See if you can guess this one before the vocals come in.
What you got?
I Can't Dance.
There you go. Genesis, Phil Collins, I Can't Dance.
Oh, okay.
Had a great video where he's just getting rejected by women. The whole video was good stuff.
All right.
Back when MTV actually played music videos.
That's right.
Back then, that was a video show that I apparently didn't watch.
All right, so we'll come back to music. I'm going to split it up into two parts there, too. So, Cass, it's that time. What you got for us in the lines of music. I'm sorry, movie trivia.
All right. So I have two from February. So I guess without giving anything away, we'll get right into the first one-star review. This was a sorry, I think my headset keeps cutting out. This was a popular movie. Might still be a popular movie to some people. So let's see what the reviewers thought. In a post-credit scene in this movie, one character said he hoped the viewers didn't think the movie sucked. Unfortunately, unlike many other critics and viewers worldwide, I did. The movie captures the rock and roll spirit of the early 1990s, but it doesn't capture enough humor to last until the end of the film. While the direction of the director is stylish and great in capturing the rocking tone of the film, and the cast features an energetic lead in his youth and the sidekick at his best, I simply found that I could not enjoy this movie.
I've got a guess.
What you got?
What's your guess?
Gremlins 2.
No.
Wow. 92. Like, oh my God. Part of me wants to say like Bill and Ted so bad, but no.
Oh, it could be that's Bill and Ted's Bogus Journey.
You're right.
I don't know when that came out.
I don't either.
It's a solid guess.
It is not a Keanu Reeves movie.
Oh, okay. Okay.
All right. Not a Keanu movie.
Is it? All right, time for a hint or two. I'm going to phone a friend for the hint. All right. Is it a technically a comedy?
Yes.
Okay. It is a comedy.
And there's
and it captures the rock energy of the early 90s. Oh, is it Clerks?
No. You guys are stuck on the Kevin. You want another review?
Sure.
Yeah.
All right. I'm afraid this isn't going to give much of a hint, but some funny parts, but a lot not. And some is just awful. The sidekick made me laugh zero. The lead is funny, but this movie sucked overall.
Something with a sidekick.
Something with the sidekick and some early 90s rock energy.
Encino Man.
Encino Man.
Which I love, by the way.
Pauly Shore and what's his face?
Brendan Fraser.
Brendan Fraser.
And Sean Austin.
And Rudy.
Yeah. I'm trying to think of sidekick-ish movies. No. I can't think of any like sidekick movies.
Are you ready for the last review before I give you a ringer clue? Okay. There are moments of hilarity. But the sketch is not built to be 90 minutes.
It's not a long movie.
Oh, I know exactly what it is.
Sketch.
Yeah, Jesus Christ, what is it? It's the Rock on Wayne's World.
Wayne's World, yes.
Oh, yeah. Good job, Wesley. I was not. That was a good clue. That was a good clue. Good catch.
Yeah. Yeah, that was good. Cheers to you, Cass. That's a good one.
Good one.
What else you got?
Party. All right. Party time. Excellent.
There it is.
Schwing. That, believe it or not, that is the movie. That movie introduced me to Queen. I had no idea who Queen was until that movie came out.
Oh, that's right. Queen. I bet we see them on the charts next month because they brought that song back big time.
They brought it back. Yes.
Yeah.
I remember the music video that had them in it.
All right, this next movie, not a lot of high reviews. It's got a Rotten Tomatoes score of 8%.
Wow, that's bad.
So it is not fresh at all. But it's one of those movies that I believe just about everybody knows about. So we will see. Part of me, I left the actual character's name. I removed the name of the actor, but I left the character's name in because I don't believe that that'll be a giveaway at all. So that tells you how great this movie was.
Okay.
All right. Sergeant Joe Bomaski is a tough cop, but when his mother comes to visit, he becomes nothing more than her little kid.
Oh.
Hey.
You already got it?
No, I've got a guess, though. Well, okay, sorry, keep the going. Rest of the review.
Yep. Okay.
Because I'm not confident.
I hate to pick on an old woman, but she's horribly annoying. She is overbearing yet lovable, clueless yet all-knowing. She's a cartoon character stereotype, and I think they want us to laugh at her. I couldn't possibly laugh at an old lady, and I didn't find any of it funny anyways.
Love these reviews.
I have pity for Joe. He can't do much here other than roll his eyes and keep saying, "Mom, Mom." This is absolutely annoying. It isn't funny, and it probably was one of the stupidest titles ever.
It is. The movie is "Stop or My Mom Will Shoot" with Sylvester Stallone.
Yes, that is it.
And I've never seen it. I just remember the trailers for it enough.
Yeah. That's why I said that I could say the name of the character and it wouldn't matter because I haven't seen it, but I know about
right,
the movie.
Because I didn't know his name in the movie, but I just know that it was about his very old mother trying to be the comedy of the movie. That's perfect. I bet he does just say, "Mom, Mom, Mom," the whole movie. That's great.
Shout out to Sylvester Stallone, though. I saw a commercial for the new Rambo movie, so whatever. Cheers to him. For whatever it's worth.
Man, still an action hero 20 years later, and he was an action hero 10 plus years before this. So, yeah.
Sure.
Yeah, I just put the trailer in the chat there.
He was doing the mandatory, you know, you got to do two or three action movies and one comedy, right? Thus we get the Kindergarten Cops and the juniors of the Schwarzenegger.
Sure.
Perfect. Stop and My Mom Will Shoot. All right. Well, let's see what the rest of the movies were in the month of February. Wayne's World number one at the box office. Hey, Stop or My Mom Will Shoot.
Stop playing.
Lured enough people in that it was number four in the box office for February. 28 million total gross from that movie. So somebody thought it was a good idea.
Never seen either of those movies.
Number two at the theater, Medicine Man, which I don't know.
Was that...
I'm going to see if I can look at a poster of it real quick. It's got Sean Connery.
What's his face?
Okay, I remember it now that I see. It's like in the jungle, Sean Connery and some young blonde girl. And probably
right.
They probably get romantic, even though it makes no sense whatsoever.
Even though it makes no sense. Because old dudes want to go to the movies and...
Right. Believe.
The dream also. Yeah, and fair enough. Old dudes want to go to the movies and believe.
Richard Gere and Kim Basinger doing what they do best with some steamy romance and suspense in the movie Final Analysis, which I've also never seen, was number three this
month.
Never
heard of that movie.
And let's see, Memoirs of an Invisible Man, number five at the theater. Another one.
So out of all those movies... Okay, I've seen parts of Wayne's World for sure. I just don't think I've ever sat down and watched the whole thing straight through.
Oh, speaking of...
I want to say that I was interested in that Invisible Man movie, though.
I was going to say, speaking of dynamic duos, here we have Chevy Chase and Daryl Hannah. So, totally...
Ooh, what movie was that?
Memoirs of an Invisible Man, which I've also never seen. Okay. The Great Mouse Detective. Is that Disney? It was reissued this month.
Yeah, I don't know.
And number six at the box office.
Sounds like Disney.
It does sound like Disney.
It is Disney. Walt Disney, Great Mouse Detective. I would argue that all three of us have seen it, and we were too young to even remember. You know, like
I know I've seen it.
Yeah. That is all of the movies that saw nationwide release. Yep.
All right. So, was anyone else making movies like animated movies?
There was that
showed up at the theaters.
Now I'm going back to like late 80s, but there was that studio that did, and I don't think this may be two different people, right? But do you guys remember these two movies? The Secret of Nim. I got three.
One of my favorites.
I got three for you. Secret of Nim, American Tail, you know, with Five-O the Mouse.
Five-O American Tail, yeah.
Yeah. And Land Before Time. Those are three non-Disney movies that were pretty fair. Big deal. Late 80s, early 90s. And what's that other one that I've never seen it, but it's very.
Ferngully.
Yep, that's the one. That is the one. Everybody loves it. I've never seen it. Save the Rainforest.
Save the Rainforest.
It's all just, right, yeah, it's just rainforest propaganda. That's why I've never.
Who in the world made. I'm interested in knowing if the same people that made Ferngully made The Secret of Nim. I love The Secret of Nim.
Yeah,
I'd like the spot in my front yard that was just super overgrown with like all these big bushes or whatever. And I cut around it all summer the first year here at the house. And I called it Nim. That was my Nim up there. And I loved the idea of. I'd see little squirrels and chipmunks and rabbits all run off and live in there. And I was sad when I cut Nim down.
That's awesome. So I said I was going to start giving some of the top television shows from this time period. Again, the ratings run from September of 1991 through April of 1992. It's really hard to track down release dates for these things. So we're just going to go over some of the top television shows each week. A few of the entries are going to be boring, and I don't. It's almost like who's going to be number two, and it's going to be that way for a while because number one is always going to be the show 60 Minutes. So,
okay.
Do you guys 60 Minute fans?
Of course not.
Okay. I didn't want to just bash it. I've probably watched.
Yeah, old people be watching 60 Minutes.
Is that wrong to feel like that's the.
That's how I feel about CBS, period. That's how I've always felt about CBS. Like, CBS is the old person network, and ABC and NBC kind of fluctuate. They fight for that middle ground spot for, like, between not old, like, regular adults, not old people adults, and children, where NBC and ABC will entertain both, and then Fox was the edgy channel
that had Bart Simpson. Yeah, Fox has always been the edgiest of the bunch, no doubt.
Which has always seemed weird to me, with Fox News being the voice of conservatism.
Oh, that is interesting. I've never really thought about that.
They had to fill that there was a gap there. So for them. I feel like for them to think they had a chance to make it successful, they had to speak to the other people.
Sure.
So they had to come up with the conservative news because, you know, CNN was liberal. MSN was a little more middle of the road, but it was still leaning a little towards more liberal. So Fox said there's this whole section of people that aren't being... Their news needs aren't being met, so let's make a bunch of crap and throw.
Such as TV. I'm not going to make too much fun of conservatives because I partially lean that way. But yeah
it's not a political statement saying let's make a bunch of crap. That was just
yeah, no doubt. Cool.
You know, I don't think we need 24-hour news cycles. There's not that much news.
Right. They break down these speeches like it's a damn
like a NFL play. Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. I think that may. Now, I'm just going to be honest. At some point, I checked out of watching news altogether. This is tangent here, but life is good when you have no clue what's going on. I can tell you that, guys. So, you know, not knocking anybody for enjoying the news, but I do think, and I feel like it is mostly a generation older than us, that the best thing any of them could do is to just stop watching the news. And these 24-hour news channels are just creating so much negative energy and social media havoc that we could all... stand to not have. And that's just a down the middle statement. Both sides could do well to just get away from the news for a while.
Yeah, bringing it back around to 92, yeah, channel your inner 13-year-old right. who didn't give a crap.
Right. The moment that little clock started ticking on 60 Minutes, it was time to find something else. Like, that's the only thing I know about the show is, like, tonight on 60 Minutes. And I'm like, tonight on 60 Minutes, we're playing Super Mario Brothers because there's nothing else to watch now. So.
Every now and then they would have like a topic, like, and by every now and then I mean like twice a year
they'd have like a sports guy or something on
that, right off the bat, so we have to find something.
So I'm gonna start at the number 13 show and just bring us up over the next few weeks, and just knowing that a few of these entries are going to be boring, so I went ahead and spoiled the top. So it's a run to see who's number two now. Number 13, Unsolved Mysteries. This was always a show that could do a good job of creeping me out.
Scariest show in the history of television shows for me. Absolutely. That is the number one scariest show in the history of television to me, without a doubt.
Yeah, from the moment the theme song came on, I was like terrified.
Like, he could have spoke a little less creepy.
He was good at his job. Like, I don't know his name, but I know exactly what he looks like.
Right? That's what it must feel like when a young girl has an old man walk up to her. Just that level of creepiness.
God. Fair enough, bro. Yeah, he was the worst. But the idea that that stuff could be real, Chucky and Freddy Krueger and all those things. I mean, I'm not going to pretend like they didn't bother me a little bit. But at the end of the day, I knew it was all bullcrap, right? But yeah, Unsolved Mysteries. Half that stuff I could for real imagine happening to me. I'm out. I'm done with Unsolved Mysteries. Scariest thing ever.
And we've all seen it. It must have had a really good time slot. And I think it was Fox. I think. I could be wrong. But it must have had a perfect time slot that, like, we were just already in front of a television when it came
out. Right. Unsolved Mysteries immediately after The Simpsons.
I think I was really feeling like it was some kind of Simpsons kind of thing.
Sure. Sure.
So number 12 is Monday Night Football. That, you know, football is going to get ratings. That's just what it is. At number 10, there's a tie for number 10, a show called Room for Two. Either of you remember that?
I remember the name. I'm sure if you gave a premise, I would remember it.
All right. Give me a second and I will try to do just that. Room for Two is an American sitcom starring Patricia Heaton and Linda Lavin, aired for two seasons on ABC. Let's see. She stars as Jill Curland, an executive producer of a New York City television show called Wake Up New York, focused on her relationship with her mother, Edie, from Ohio, who joined Jill's show as a result of her humorous and misplaced opinions and criticism. I've never seen this show.
Nope. I remember that show.
That's not ringing a bell.
Yeah, I'm looking at it now. I just remember that chick with the short hair. And you guys know me. I'm on the record as saying, a pretty face and a short little pixie haircut. I'm in like flam, bro. That's my jam. Particularly, whatever. Like short hair, pretty faces. I remember that chick.
Now, the show that it is tied with for number 10, I did watch a lot of this one. This was Coach. You guys remember Coach?
Yeah,
Craig Coach T. Nelson. Awesome show. Mm-hmm. And
but what school did he coach at?
Oh, good question. I can cheat and answer this question.
Well, don't cheat.
Was it a university, right?
Yeah, it was like a real university. Oh, at least I think it was.
Well, I don't feel like it was in Ohio.
Like, I don't know for sure. I have. Okay, so my guess is Minnesota.
Yeah, I feel like it was up north. Midwest.
Okay, so you are right, except it's not a real university.
It's
so
not a real school.
He is the head coach of the fictional NCAA Division I Minnesota State University Screaming Eagles.
There you go. Okay.
Both of his assistant coaches is or whatever they were, Jerry Van Dyke and the guy Dauber.
Check you out. Yeah,
they were both great.
Yeah, great show, great cast. lovable characters.
Yeah, absolutely. And then the number nine show that we're going to close out with on the television for today was Major Dad. I did not like it.
Yeah, as was much that like as a CBS people. Sitcom?
Yep, you got it. So
yep. Yeah, miss CBS. Me. Old people sitcom. I'm good.
I know that I watched several episodes of it, but
me too.
I don't have any fond, you know, like love for it.
You know why I probably watched episodes of it? Because my great aunt and grandma were watching Wheel of Fortune.
And it came Jeopardy, on right after. And
I'm sure it came on right around
that is
either before or after those shows.
That is perfect. Back in the days where we were sharing televisions for the most part, you know.
What kind of life or childhood did you live if you weren't forced to watch Wheel of Fortune?
Right? We only had one TV for the longest time.
Yeah, no doubt. I'm going to use Forrest very loosely in that sentence also.
Right.
Wheel of Fortune isn't a bad show.
it's not a bad show, but then there's also that argument that if you've seen one, you've seen them all.
I'll say this for Wheel of Fortune. It was entertaining enough that I rented the Wheel of Fortune video game multiple times.
I'm guilty of renting Wheel of Fortune and even worse, Jeopardy, the video game, which is the most miserable game you could ever play.
Not nearly as fun. Wheel of Fortune was a better game.
You had to be like savant level to answer the questions on those Jeopardy video games. It's crazy.
So yeah, one of our things to do. That's kind of an exaggeration. Something that we did one night while drinking with some friends is turned on like Jeopardy videos on YouTube, which is a thing. There's a bunch of Jeopardy videos on YouTube, and we called out answers incorrectly 99% of the time, like we were watching the show for real, and it was super fun.
Sounds
drinking
fun.
And watching Jeopardy. I'm sure you can make a drinking game out of that.
Oh man, if the drinking game is if you get the question wrong, you drink, then that game is bad news.
I'm torn by it.
It'd have to be if you get the question right.
If you get a question right, the other people drink. That's the way to play it, right? That's the way to play it, that it doesn't end after one column, you know, where everyone's alcohol poisoned after the first column.
I've had three shots already.
Three questions in. I can't
three
see.
Questions in.
And when you get to the Daily Double, goodness gracious.
Bro, I'm down for this game.
Okay, I think we've all established that we have the premise of a good drinking game here.
Cool.
Let's knock out the video games of February 92 real quick from Game Pro Magazine 92. You guys, as a retro game lover that I am, I have found, and I'm going to share a secret with everybody. I almost hate sharing my great secrets, but everybody needs to know this. Archive.org is a great website where you can look up all kinds of stuff, but in this example, old magazines. And I've just had a great time reading these old game pros for this information. Like I want to do a video just about reading Game Pro magazines. That's how good they are. So, the big news is continued hype for the Sega CD coming out probably this summer of 92. And NEC with the TurboGrafx is also releasing a Turbo Duo, which is a CD attachment coming in the fall. As I said last time around, Sega CD is probably my second favorite system ever, and I love it. Although it is not headed towards very much success here in America. Anyway, Hot in the Arcade, Dragon's Lair 2, and WWF WrestleFest.
That was fun. Was that one of those, what, like eight controllers around a thing?
There were at least four, and like everybody was in the ring just button mashing.
Yeah, those were good times in the arcade, bro.
No one knew how to do any of the cool moves. You just sort of got lucky if it happened. That's how.
But it was fun.
And Dragon's Lair 2, sequel to Dragon's Lair, of course, but two of the games where... I don't know if any of you guys remember these from the arcade. You know, it's the animated game. Right. And it basically just had a trackball or something in the middle. you were watching a cartoon play out and you just had to hit the right direction at the right time. Insanely hard, and it cost $1 to play, and you would be dead in the first minute of playing it. It was
so what's the name of it? Dragon's Lair?
Dragons, plural, like dragon plural. So Dragon's right. Lair. You've seen it at some point. And it does make a cameo in season two of Stranger Things, as a matter of fact. NES releases of the month. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 3 comes out on the original NES. It is trying very much to be an arcade game, because at this point the Ninja Turtles arcade game is a big deal. So graphically, obviously very inferior, but still does it. It's serviceable as an arcade port.
Yeah, that was a straight up arcade port, right?
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, that was awesome. That was fun. It was a great time in the arcades and a fun time at home.
Absolutely. Also, Data East, who most notable to me for the game Bad Dudes, they're good at beat 'em ups. They make Captain America and the Avengers, which I think is also a port of an arcade beat 'em up, sort of like Ninja Turtles. There's a game called Kickmaster that looks awesome. There's a game called Bard's Tale that is a port of a PC game to the NES, which is kind of a weird and interesting ordeal at that time. Moving over to the Genesis, the Terminator, which is actually based on the original Terminator, even though Terminator 2 is upon us. Really well-reviewed game. It's also going to come out on Sega CD later and just be an awesome game. I think... So you're not playing as Arnold in this one. You're playing as other guy from Terminator 1 that nobody remembers.
Yo, so there's another Terminator movie coming out?
Yeah, I barely know about it, and it's even got Linda. It's not Linda Hamill, is it? Is it Linda Hamill? Maybe.
Is that right? I don't know.
Original Sarah Connor. Yeah.
Yeah, the original Sarah Connor
is in it. I don't know if this is a good idea or not. You know,
I kind of get the feeling that they're going to act like that the movies past, you know, Terminator 2 just didn't happen. I kind of get that feeling that, you know, they're going to like, yeah, that Terminator Salvation, that, you know, that was just somebody's dream that didn't happen.
Right.
Really? You think so? I was okay with going all in on that. I know we're derailing right now, but yeah, I was good with the line that was following, but I'm interested. Sarah Connor doing her thing. My fear is that it's going to be girl power shoved down my throat. So I don't know. We'll see. That's my fear.
Old girl power.
As the father to two daughters. I mean, I'm for it. Girls rock. Who runs the world? Right. Girls, whatever, all that. But there's only so much, I don't know, PC affirmative action. I don't know. It could be a lot. I hope it's not too much. I hope it's not girl power. Spice Girls meets Terminator.
We need to bring back Claire Danes from Terminator 3 and tie this all into super girl power. Terminator 3 was not terrible to me, although I've never like went back and referenced it for plot holes or anything. But
I like all of them.
Yeah, after Terminator 3, I actually haven't seen any. So,
yeah, I haven't watched Terminator Salvation or
Genesis. The one with Batman.
I haven't watched all of them. Right, sure. I
can't remember all of them.
I've seen at least one of those. I've seen a few of them. I haven't seen all of them. All I'm saying is that of all of them that I have seen, I've always been entertained. And the storyline continues, and it's a story that I'm interested in. You know what I mean?
It's because it's telling our future.
Sure.
It's telling the
Skynet.
Somewhere between The Matrix and Terminator is a prediction of things to come.
Yo, you know they're making... So there's a...
I've heard that Keanu and the girl are coming back for a new Matrix.
Okay, so yeah, The Matrix is coming back out, but this is another tangent. They're making... afterlife social media presences if you will. So when a person dies, all of their social media material and then maybe just some stuff that they wanted known about themselves is uploaded to the cloud or uploaded to a server somewhere.
There's a Black Mirror episode basically about that.
Okay. Yeah,
which is, should be telling you that that's a bad idea.
Okay, so there's that. But they're all the same. One of the companies that's doing the same type of a thing is making or wants to make holographic images that you can talk to and all these other things of your dead relatives and people, right?
This is so Black Mirror.
It's a hologram, and you're supposed to be able to talk to your dead grandpa or whatever, or have conversations with, you know, that tech spins over into other things where, like, you learn from Socrates and blah, 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 and you can give your only child an imaginary friend. Their imaginary friend becomes real is the way that it was kind of spun in the story that I heard about it. But
or Selma Hayek,
the possibilities are endless and horrible and horrifying.
Horrible and interesting and mostly horrible and scary when you really think about it.
Yeah, you think about them making computers feel feelings and all these other things. Oh, my God, no. Terminator's, man, just to bring it back around. Terminator is happening, bro. That shit is happening.
Then you need to get the game on Genesis and learn how to deal with these
boom
immediately. Also on Genesis this month, Rings of Power, which looked awesome. War Song was so-so. And my interesting-looking game of the month is El Viento, where you play as a what looked like a female assassin in a side-scrolling shooter. Looked awesome, had great reviews. Moving on to Super Nintendo, the game Joe and Mac. Anybody? All right. It looks like it was like cavemen trying to save their cave women who had gotten kidnapped. So you're like running through prehistoric times, jumping on dinosaurs and stuff. Looked pretty cool. Looked like it might have been in the arcade, maybe. But was reasonably popular. And what was definitely in the arcade was a game called Smash TV. Anybody? No?
Yeah.
Okay. Which was like one of those three or four player, like top down shooters. Came to Super Nintendo, also did Super Tennis. Over on the TurboGrafx, we had Night Creatures, and as referenced at the end of our last episode, the Addams Family game. Over on Game Boy, we had Mega Man Zero, a port of the original Metroid, which was pretty cool. And here's, I put this one in just because an original Star Trek game, by that I mean the original cast, and I just, even in 92, I find that interesting that we were making games about OG Star Trek. It's just crazy what a following Star Trek has had through the years.
I'm going to say, like, OG Star Trek had movies going into the late 80s at the very least. Oh,
you're right. You are right. And maybe beyond. Like,
and maybe early 90s, right.
Maybe mid-90s. I mean, they went on for some time.
Because they went on until they transitioned over to Next Generation. So when did Next Generation come out?
Yeah.
Say early 90s, and it had to establish itself before it actually got a movie?
The one that we're most likely all more familiar with because it came on at like 6-7 p.m. every day for us.
Our Captain Picard is my captain.
Absolutely.
With all due respect to Kirk, it's Captain Picard.
And their little chamber that they went into to have the most awesome virtual reality ever was my favorite episode.
Oh, that holodeck was wild. Yeah, no doubt.
Everything, every system known to man at this point is getting a video game based on the Hook movie, the one with Robin Williams.
Oh, my God. I adore the Peter. I love the Peter Pan story. You couldn't tell me that I wasn't a lost boy for forever. And right up in with... So the game came out, which makes the movie relevant and fairly new, right? It was one of the books that I ever read that was based on a movie. Read the book before I watched the movie and just fell in love with those characters and everything. And I used to have dreams. One of my recurring dreams in life was that Peter Pan flew to my house and carried me off to Neverland, whatever. Oh, my God. I love that. I love Hook. Cheers to Robin Williams. Pour out a little liquor for him.
Right. Julia Roberts as Tinkerbell.
Oh my God, sexy as heck, Tinkerbell.
That's right. You were talking about Pixies. This is perfect. Doesn't get much more Pixie than that.
Yeah, at all. I got a thing for Tinkerbell and Julia Roberts.
Sonic the Hedgehog for Game Gear comes out. There's the first look at a new Bart Simpson game, Bart's Nightmare, coming to Super Nintendo. I just wanted to throw this in there because this popped up in last month's issue and this throughout the issue, just advertisements for American Gladiators. American Gladiators is apparently a big deal during this time.
Of course it is.
Is it?
Of course it is. Goldbergs. You guys ever watch the show The Goldbergs?
No, I think you talked about it recently, and I've kind of wanted to check it out.
I've seen one or two episodes.
It's worth a watch. But like they sometimes try and pull pop culture references into the 80s because the show was supposed to be based in the 80s. So they just to pull up old school pop culture references, they'll screw up the timeline sometimes, and they have the American Gladiators kind of firmly in the 80s, which is weird to me.
Which is not correct.
Yeah, not correct at all. I don't think, right? I feel like, whatever.
It could have
maybe
theoretically started in the late 80s, but it feels like an early 90s thing.
Yeah, I feel like I was watching American Gladiators while I was at Beulah. Right.
They would always, like, let's find the scrawniest dude who would dare to enter this contest and put him up against two 250-pound jacked dudes.
Nitro.
Nitro and Firestarter or whatever their names were. We're going to beat him to death with these padded bow staffs, whatever those things are called.
I don't remember it like that. Was it that bad for real? They weren't finding real athletes. They were finding scrubs and beating them up.
Every now and then they'd get like a legit athlete. I think he conned his way on the show.
Right.
Right.
Because he would be like super fast. Super and fast. Big, beefy guys just couldn't. Yeah. He just squirt around him and he would beat him at everything.
What did y'all bring this bum out here for?
He faked being slow throughout the tryouts, and then he gets to the show and like, they just can't catch him. He's juked him again.
You know they were roided up too. They were probably pissed off.
Yeah. No doubt.
I didn't come here for that bullshit. Y'all embarrassing me on TV.
Okay, and back cover was the game Tiny Toon Adventures coming to an NES near you.
Tiny Toon Adventures.
Tiny Toons and Animaniacs were my jam.
Me too. Which one was
they blend together to me?
Yeah, me too. So I'm like, I'm trying to remember Tiny Toons versus Animaniacs.
The Animaniacs were the ones that were like, looked like Mickey Mouse, except not, right?
Right, yeah. They were totally different shows, and the Tiny Toons were just small versions of the Warner Brothers characters.
Yeah, like a
Daffy Duck's little cousin or something. Or was it actually Daffy Duck?
A baby Bugs Bunny.
And Babs.
Babs Bunny, who mysteriously disappears in the future.
Yeah, they created Babs just for that show, right?
Which came first? Is she the pretty bunny girl in Space Jam?
Was there a pretty bunny girl in Space Jam?
Isn't there some little
bunny that
Bugs is in love with?
Is that Babs?
I don't, I'll have to go look into that. But if that's not Grown Up Babs, then that's a mistake.
Then that's a mistake.
Yeah, because she came out in Space Jam and their jaws hit the floor.
Right.
Lola Bunny is the Looney Tunes cartoon character portrayed as an anthropomorphic female rabbit who first appeared in the 1996 film Space Jam.
Lola, okay. So
Lola. I'm with you. That's weak. Why isn't it Babs?
Continuity. I guess maybe Babs isn't meant to grow up to be sexy like Lola Bunny.
Whatever. Okay. I forgot that was a thing. Shout out to Lola Bunny, who's kind of cute for a bunny.
Right. I mean, if we can address animals as being attractive, She's drawn she's drawn correctly to be said.
God, only the artist didn't make no mistakes with her. All right, whatever. Okay.
Yeah, and kind of staying in this arena here, like when I got home from school during this time, like my whole afternoon was Animaniacs, Tiny Toons, and Batman the Animated Series. I think Batman was the first one to come on.
Yeah. Like, that sounds right to me.
I would rush off the bus so that I could get home in time to catch Batman.
That sounds absolutely right to me.
I don't feel like I was watching Batman then, and I'm like regretting my childhood now for not being able to see Batman as much as I love
it. It was released, or the series started in 1992, so it all ties in.
Wow.
That's pretty cool. Yeah, as hard as I am on Batman fans now, it's only because I'm a Batman fan also.
Right.
I'm just honest about who he is in comparison to Superman. That's all that is. I'm just honest about who the Caped Crusader is.
That show, still to this day, that Batman animated series is revered as being like one of the best, you know, comic book adaptations, or just Batman in general. Like, people love it.
Mm-hmm. I can comfortably accept the argument of that being the best Batman. With all due respect to Keaton.
Transitioning back into music, we still got a few songs to go, creeping up to number one of February 1992. So tell me if you heard this one. Come on, you guys are going to get this.
It's a little choppy.
Yeah, it's cutting out. I can't hear it.
Oh,
yeah, Tears in Heaven.
Oh, let me bring it up a little bit.
Saddest song ever. I don't want to hear that.
Oh, it is. This, especially if you know the story behind it.
Yeah, no, that song makes me cry. I hate that song. Right. It's a beautiful song, and whatever.
All right. Ready for, I don't want to tip this one off, but I'm going to say, and I've turned it up a little bit, maybe you guys can hear it better, one of the top five most attractive women of all time. I may have tipped it off too much, though.
Mariah. Oh, Vanessa Williams, right?
Absolutely.
Best for last.
Yeah. I just saw her. Oh, you know where I saw her? She was at the US Open watching Serena's match the other night.
This one's going to be way too easy, but it's on the list, so we're noteworthy.
Hey.
Hammer had two songs on the list.
Of course he did. He was the man. Hammer was the man. And hip-hop needs to respect who he was and not just try to make him a cartoon character. Hammer was the man.
All right. Now, here's one I only put on here because this is a very special segment that I'm going to call "This is the Worst Song to Ever Come Out of the 90s. Tell me if you've heard it, and then I'll attempt to explain the misery that is this song.
But it's on the Billboard list.
It's high on the Billboard list. So these songs, I'm going to give you the top three when we get to them, but they are going in ascending order. I'm going to say this one is around number seven on the charts without All having right. the chart in front of me. So, all right, nothing yet. Let me fast forward a bit. It's just a weird song.
Is this Paula Abdul?
It is.
Is this Scat Cat?
No.
No, that's a great song.
That is a great song, Candace. We're going to pretend you didn't say that.
That's the only Paula Abdul song I can think of right now.
Yeah, it's like Straight Up Now Tell Me. And this is probably a song that was released after she had a super popular song come out.
This is Vibology. Anybody remember Vibology? Oh,
nope. I'm good.
It is not good. It is not good.
I'm good on that.
All right, so here we are at top three songs, February 1992.
Hey, there she is.
You guys will get this one easy enough.
Oh, is that? I love your smile.
But I love your smile. Yep.
Is that Shanice?
That's right. Shanice. Yep. Not
yet. Shanice. Okay.
So I brought her up last week.
Yeah, I love her. Such a sweet sounding song.
I loved it. I won't even try to lie. I loved it. All right, number two. Number two.
Feel good.
It's coming.
Oh, Mr. Big.
Yes.
Why can't I think of the name? The One to Be With You?
That's right.
I remember that song.
Very good. And number one. No, that's not it. Number 64, my love. 64,
my love. Love's going to leave. Right, said Fred. They were number one?
They were number one. This was actually even on the trivia that I decided to omit this fact.
Who is this?
Right, said Fred.
Right, said Fred.
Oh, that's too sexy? Too sexy, it hurts. And the name of them is Right, said Fred?
Yep.
Okay.
And America loved them.
Sure.
All right. So that is your number one song, February 1992. I got a few more bits of trivia to wrap things up. And
what you got?
All right. So coming back around.
Eddie Murphy.
February 10th. I don't have any Eddie Murphy news this month. Mike Tyson convicted. I know. Sorry. In the case against Desiree Washington. February 11th, F-16 jet crashes at residential district of Hengelo, Netherlands. I don't remember that story, but it is an interesting story that F-16 just random crashes into a neighborhood. That's not a fun
time. In where?
In the Netherlands.
Oh,
that'd be huge international news today.
I feel like there's more to that story, right?
I may have to do some digging.
Yeah.
That's Big Brother spying on.
Yeah. Yeah. Where's the Netherlands? I'm trying to...
That's
in that little trio of fingers, right?
No, she's up there somewhere, you know?
Yeah, whatever. It's somewhere.
Up there above the UK, I think. It's not funny, probably. But if you're just reading it factually and don't have a memory of it, then I'm going to say it was sort of funny. So on February 13th, Jose Canseco repeatedly rams his Porsche into his wife Esther's BMW. Not sure why, although I don't.
You can make some guesses, right?
Right. Yeah. Now, I think there was obviously there was some legal. Like maybe he was arrested, maybe he wasn't, but somehow the police got involved with this. Why else would we know, right? The interesting extra to this story is a week later, there's a story about a guy that backs his car into Jose Canseco's Lamborghini. So Jose's just having a rough month.
With his vehicle.
Yeah, at this point.
It sucks to be Jose Canseco, but it's...
Again, just...
Good to be Jose Canseco also?
I guess. Was he ever wrapped up in steroids?
Yeah, right? Like, that's why I'm saying...
That's why you would repeatedly ram your Porsche into your wife.
Yeah, that's BMW. What I'm saying. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yeah, you can make some guesses. I'm going to say roid rage, probably, yeah, right?
Probably, right.
If not like coke rage. But yeah, I think he's the one who... famously spilled the beans.
He wrote that book Juiced that several people
about Tupac and I'm sorry.
It was later converted into a screenplay.
Yeah. The director had a really different vision for it. February 15, Jeffrey Dahmer is found sane and guilty of the murder of 15 boys.
That didn't seem right.
I don't know if I'd say sane, but guilty I can agree with.
Well, right? I'm with you. I think that the point was they weren't going to let him plead insanity on the case. Like, it was done with intent.
Yeah, I understand the legal wording. It's just not something a sane person does.
Fair.
Yeah, like, so what is the argument? Like, you can't argue, like, wanting to eat people is sane, right? Is there ever a point where that's sane? So is the argument that he was sane in the killings, but insane in the disposal of the bodies? I don't know. God, that's weird.
Yeah. Basically, they were saying he was of sound mind.
Fair. I'll accept that.
I'll accept it for the outcome that they were trying to get.
At the end of the day, you get rid of them, right? But no, we didn't do that. We just locked them up. We should have put them on a damn barbecue spittle or whatever you call them. But the punishment fit the crime.
Right. Yeah. How different things would be. Brightening it up a little bit. On February 16th, former silver Goodyear blimps are now going to be painted yellow and blue. So Goodyear changes their classic. The silver blimp is now going to be yellow and blue. On the 16th of February, the 34th Daytona 500. I thought the Daytona 500 of all races would be at least worth throwing in here. Davey Allison joins his father, Bobby, as the race winner. Sort of foreshadowing not great news is Richard Petty and AJ Foyt. This will be their final drive in this event. So, Richard Petty just retired, didn't he? He didn't. He's not one of those that died on the track, right?
Yeah. Because remember, he was in that Cars movie from Disney.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
Love those movies.
That's on cue for Madeline. We've been going through a lot of Disney stuff lately.
Yeah, I missed a lot of Disney during my 20s for sure, and early 30s definitely. I just missed a lot of Disney, so it's cool catching up on all that with Elena. That's been
right.
That's been a blast. And Cars was one of those things that I just totally missed, but whatever. I've watched them all multiple times now, and Planes. And that second Planes movie makes me cry every time.
I've never seen the Planes movies, so I'm going to have to get to those.
Yeah, they're good.
It's got Dane Cook, believe it or not, is the voice of the main character, the main plane.
Is that right?
Yeah, what's his name? Dusty Crop Duster or something?
Yeah, something like that. Something like that. Yeah, those movies are good, bud. And if you don't already have a respect for public service people, particularly firefighters, and those guys that fight like the big fire, whatever. Anyway, the movies are cool. Watch them. Pixar does their thing. Pixar knows the code, though.
Right, right? Yeah. They've got the formula down. They're going to make you cry. They know how.
Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead.
It's not a Disney movie till somebody dies.
You know, I was, again, getting off topic here, but we watched The Lion King a couple of days ago, Madeline and I did. And
live action or
original? No, I'm sorry. I still haven't seen the new one. We watched the original one. So,
okay.
But it did make me think how like formulaic they were for a time where it's like you're going to introduce the character when the character is young, and some event is going to go by where we get the montage and the character grows up. There's a tragedy. They have to overcome the tragedy. That's every movie. For some time, like, because that little growing up montage, like, it may happen via happy or it may happen via tragedy, but like something's gonna happen and they gotta grow up. And that was just like, this is just feeling very formulaic. Yeah, maybe that's one of the things that made Toy Story stand out, is that it did at least follow unconventional plots for Disney movies.
Fair enough. There came a point where I don't give Disney credit for Pixar movies.
That's true.
Toy Story is a solely Pixar movie. I don't believe Disney had bought Pixar at that point.
Right. Yeah, that's what, you know, like, they get no credit for them. This is just almost like their distribution.
Right. Yeah, they own the studio, but they have nothing to do with the work, which is how it's best. And we watched that movie Zootopia the week before.
That's a good one. That one's cute.
Yes.
Which again follows, you know, here's a young little rabbit. Something happens. She grows up, joins the police.
Oh, sure. Yep. That's a thing. Yeah, Zootopia is good, though.
Yeah, it's a good one.
And that Shakira song is one of Elena's favorites.
It's a good song.
What else you got?
All right. The February 16th, but again, you were kind of guessing a lot of things that were going to happen this month. L.A. Lakers retire Magic Johnson's number 32 uniform. So, I'm guessing that All-Star game was his last appearance, and that was just like the farewell, right?
Maybe, right? Because I feel like I thought that 92 championship for the Bulls was against the Lakers, right? But you said that was the 92 All-Star game. I'm wondering if it's not the case that it was the 91-92 season that was Magic's last season. And then he played the All-Star game in 92 the next... No, that doesn't make sense. Whatever. Okay. Magic's last year.
Well, it does. I mean, the All-Star game has always been in the middle of the season, right?
It's in the middle of the season. That's right.
But they're retiring his uniform now. So it's like, would lead you to believe he retired mid-season.
Didn't he get cut or something in a game? And that was pretty much...
Oh, and everybody's like, I ain't dealing with this.
Is that the way it happened? I remember Isaiah wasn't with that at all. that was a problem. It was so weird. Because that's the closest thing I get to celebrity drama and gossip at that age. And I still only kind of cared. But I think it was like Isaiah and a few other people, but famously Isaiah was like, nah, I'm not with that at all. And who could blame him? Nobody knew what was going on with AIDS in the 90s. Dave Chappelle once said what a lot of us knew or what a lot of us believed about AIDS was that people were getting it from doing strange things with monkeys. Like, people just didn't know what was going on with it at the time, is all I'm saying. So,
right. And all they knew was there was no cure for it, and you were going to die.
You were going to die, without a doubt. No cure for it, you're going to die, and random other urban legends about it.
You know, he's going to come back. I hate this. I guess I'm spoiling a future episode, but...
No, not at all.
Apparently, because I was trying to figure out the depth of this, is and I still haven't found quite the details of that retirement, but I do know that... In 96, the 96 season, he somehow gets back into playing shape and does get to come. And he plays at least a partial season, because it's talking about he played against the Golden State Warriors on his debut back.
Yeah, I remember that. Was he a player coach?
He was a coach, like a straight up coach. He returned to the NBA as coach of the Lakers at the end of the 93-94 season, replacing Randy Fund and Bill Bertka as interim coach for a couple games. I guess that didn't work out. And, came back for the 95-96 season. So
I was listening to, that 30 for 30 on the owner of the Clippers. What's his name? Why can't I think of his name? I'm the one listening to the thing.
Like the current anyway, owner?
No, the owner of the Clippers that got recorded saying those racist things.
Oh, yeah.
Good Lord, what is that man's name? Because his mistress...
Was it Donald went to a Sterling?
Donald Sterling.
Yeah.
Because his mistress went to a basketball game with Magic or whatever, right? So she famously recorded him saying that she doesn't... saying that he didn't want her walking around and being seen in public with black people, blah, 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 blah. And it turns out that the person that she was with was magic. But when he was trying to do his apology tour or whatever, he ended up on 60 Minutes, right? Or something like that. And instead of apologizing, he starts doubling down on why magic sucks. And he's like, magic ran around the country sleeping with all the women in all the cities, and he got AIDS, and brought it back, and why is he such a good guy, and blah, 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 blah. And that's an interesting take on that situation, because we kind of just fell back in love with him, and I love him to this day. I say magic is the man, but it's interesting.
He gets kicked out of pass, didn't he? Yeah.
Yeah, he gets pushed out of the league for having HIV that he got from not his wife.
Right.
And then he immediately is given a job as a head coach because they need him in LA because he sells tickets like crazy because people just love him. He's just super duper lovable.
Like, there's a lot in this story that's just kind of been brushed over. Like, you don't really think about the fact that while he contacted HIV, he was married.
Right.
You know, right. And when Kobe got caught with that girl in Colorado, it was like big news.
That's right.
But
well, that Magic was also Johnson, because it was possibly rape.
So. Yeah, that was what it was, which I don't know. I'm still unclear on that whole situation.
Sure. Only two people know.
Right. Yeah. But I mean, it was a big deal, and like you just never heard.
Nah, it was just sadness for him.
Yeah, you never heard, and you never heard his wife's side of the story.
Yep. Yep, absolutely. So,
what is it?
That was weird. I just heard Donald Sterling saying that today. Magic Johnson, such and such, and I went and I prayed for him, but he gets all this love. And then even the reporter who was reading the story was like, "Yeah, Magic gets all the love because he deserves the love." And I'm like, "Yeah, maybe, but he did go and catch AIDS and take that shit back to his wife, potentially, right?"
But now he's cured,
which is crazy.
He's given several whatever. What he says about it makes sense to me. Have we talked about this before? The theory that he doesn't really have it, and then the other theory that he's wealthy enough and a super athlete, so he was in prime position to really be able to fight it off by being super healthy and throwing the best medicine that money can buy at it.
When I was reading South about Park his comeback, he was getting in they were talking about how he had gotten his bench up to like 300 pounds and like things that you don't hear people with AIDS doing. Like he was, right. Yeah.
Yeah. He's gaining weight. Everybody else was losing.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. But all that said, cheers to Magic. He's my, when I want to pick a fight, argument for best NBA player ever.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah. Like if I ever want to get on the, well, let's slow down on how great is Jordan conversation. Magic was that dude. He was huge, a point guard for real, but he played center when his team needed him, when the greatest center ever couldn't finish the NBA Finals and won Finals MVP by playing center in the Finals.
As a rookie, right?
As a rookie, and he only got better? Yeah, no, Magic is that dude. Like, Jordan won championships after Magic got kicked out of the league.
I mean, were your factual statements. What do you do?
Sure.
But he did also have the greatest center that ever played.
There's also that. I'll argue Jordan's 96 team was better than any team that Magic played with, but they weren't that much better, so it's a weak argument, but I'll argue it.
I got a few more facts for us here. So on February 20th, Ross Perot says he'll be running for president this year on the Larry
Lovable
King
Lovable character
show.
In my mind.
Yeah, I have nothing but strange memories of Ross Perot and his Like he, I don't know if they were like written or printed, but he'd have these charts behind him, and he was trying to explain economics to people on infomercials. You know, it was good stuff.
I just Saturday Night Live when Dana Carvey, who was Dana Carvey
ruined Ross Perot's chances.
Dana Carvey ruined Ross Perot's chances, but he also like raised his visibility exponentially, right?
Fair enough, yeah. Like it, he made him, you know, more people knew who he was, yeah, because of Dana Carvey. But he might have also buried him at the same time.
SNL does that for presidents, like they are even presidential candidates, if you will.
They try.
They change the way you view them. Is
yeah,
kind of where I'm going. Like George W. Bush is a lovable character,
right?
When he should be a lot more hated than he is by liberals. Liberals, and I'm going to say we in this case, kind of like him. Like, hey, that's Michelle Obama's boy, and he's fun.
I can't think of him as anything but goofy and likable.
Yep, but he's also the guy who got us in the longest war.
Right. And I would take Alec Baldwin's Donald Trump over the real thing any day. That Baldwin is so good.
Yeah, Baldwin softens who Trump is, though.
Right, exactly. Like, that's what I mean. Like Baldwin just you know can't even portray how illogical and irrational some of the Trump stuff is. It just comes off as being a smug idiot. And I love the way he portrays it.
Mm-hmm. I'm trying to remember. The guy who played, I can't think of his name, the guy who played Obama.
Oh, I can't think of his name either.
But yeah.
Good job.
Oh, maybe. He didn't really stick out to me like that. He was all right. I remember his Obama impersonation. Cheers to that. I just can't remember his name right now.
Did you guys, on that tangent, did you guys ever, I don't even know if it was played by Key and Peele. It might have been played by Peele, but like they did some Obama sketches where one person was Obama, but Key was his translator, and he would like yell at the people.
He's the best,
and that was just the best. And then at some point, Obama actually went to meet him and got to kind of do it for real, and that was great.
Yeah, that was at one of those press dinners, the White House press dinners or whatever, where it's supposed to be funny and joking. One of those dinners that many people believe is the reason that we have a President Trump now, because
really,
who was it that? Yeah,
we're going so far off. We're sinking this ship right now. But that is an interesting topic.
Yeah, Trump got super embarrassed. They made a ton of jokes. I want to say it was like Seth Meyers and some other people made fun of Trump because Trump had been like calling into Fox News and for two decades, he'd been hinting at running for president. So he was there, and they went after him because he had been calling Fox News like we now know he does, right? He was just calling him every morning, giving his Trump report. And
wow,
for whatever reason, all the comedians decided to go in at Trump at the White House press dinner.
So this is their
fault.
And
he's sitting there just getting railed. Yeah, about him wanting to become president.
Called him on his bluff, and he's like, well, I guess I got to do it now.
Joke's on them.
Yeah, they're getting paid off of it now, though.
Yeah.
The ugly little thing in the room, right, the monster in the corner, is that Seth Meyers and who's that guy? Stephen Colbert? Never been more famous.
True. February 21st. Christy Yamaguchi of the U.S. wins Olympic gold in women's figure skating. Everybody,
I remember that being a big deal.
Why was it a big deal, though? I remember that too. Was it because she was Asian?
Come on,
skating for the U.S. or what?
Plus, it's figure skating. Not really. Like, we care about women's figure skating.
Right.
That's what I was saying. Like about the Olympics. There's the only things I feel like everyone kind of gets into is women's gymnastics, women's figure skating, and track and field. And then we start, like Cass said, we kind of started caring about swimming with Michael Phelps. And then apparently, like, there are moments, you know, Jenner and all that, but Jenner was track and field also. But yeah, we care about ice skating.
At the 34th Grammy Awards on February 25th, big winners are Mark Tone and the song Unforgettable. You guys remember that one where it was Natalie Cole singing with her...
With her dad, yeah.
Sort of singing with her dad, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yep, absolutely. That's still a super cool thing in my head. Yeah. When I hear the song,
the video, there's a level
of scientific coolness to it,
right,
that you don't really capture from the song, because I was listening to it with Aaron or Elena at some point. I was like, yeah, this is a cool song because she sings it with her dad, but it's not that cool because it's just a pretty song about the video.
And the
they do things like that all the time now, where back then it was much more of a big deal.
It was innovative, dub, yeah.
To dub that together, yeah.
Yep.
She gets credit for maybe not being the first, but the first of note. And also at the Grammy Awards, the Lifetime Achievement Award goes to, tell me if you know this.
Oh, yeah. Who is it? Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Them.
The greatest man alive. What's his name, man?
This is
BB King, is it?
BB King or...
This is Muddy Waters.
Muddy Waters, Jesus Christ. I should lose a card or something.
Mannish Boy by Muddy Waters.
I've got two Muddy Waters CDs. They're good.
Yeah. Obviously one of the greats winning this award, but thought that was a good audio track to go out on. That's what I got for this month. Any final thoughts?
Mike Tyson didn't do it.
Well, evidence would suggest otherwise.
Was there evidence? Oh, okay. We're not going to go down that road. We love you, Mike.
All right. Well, thanks for tuning in for February of 1992. We appreciate you guys giving us a watch or listen, and we will see you next time for March of 92.